Good morning. Welcome to Victoria's Faith. I'm Cherri Campbell. Happy Thanksgiving Day Eve, too. Praise the Lord. I hope you're getting ready for a great break tomorrow and a day to worship God, giving him the glory and the thanks for what he has done. Hallelujah. Now we're studying the lesson, Proofs That Abundance Is God's Will. Proofs That Abundance Is God's Will. And we are on proof number 18, looking at the covenant. And we are particularly in this proof looking at the old covenant and seeing that prosperity and abundance is part of God's covenant exchange with man, as it is the promise and reward for keeping the covenant. Abundance or prosperity is the reward God promises for keeping the covenant. And in the last few programs, we've talked about this. If you're going to study covenant, you have to start with Abram. Abram, the man God cut covenant with. And I've told you in the last couple programs that I've done a complete series on this study of blood covenant. What it is, a blood covenant, what's the process? We walked through the process and the steps of making a covenant, cutting a covenant. And then I showed you how Jesus perfectly fulfilled every single one of those steps. Hallelujah. He did it all. Jesus did it all. Glory to God. And so we have our blood covenant with God. But we're looking at God's covenant in the Old Testament, and how he cut that covenant with Abram. And every covenant has both obligations and requirements of both parties, and then reward to both parties for keeping the covenant. And so we saw in Genesis 12, the requirement of Abram was to leave his family and his country and go to another land. And then in Genesis 17, the requirement was to walk before God blamelessly, or that is wholeheartedly and devotedly. And then in Genesis 22, the biggest test of his life, the greatest demand on him in his whole life, God said, offer your son Isaac to me as a burnt offering. And that was a test. And Abram obeyed. And he qualified for the rewards, And so the promise and reward in Genesis 12, the promise was, I will make you into a great nation. I will bless you. I will make your name great. In Genesis 13, I will give you this land. In Genesis 15, a son from your own body and the land. And now, Then in Genesis 17, the reward was to make Abram, to multiply Abram exceedingly, multiply him exceedingly. And in the Hebrew, it's exceedingly in Genesis 17, too. And in verse 6, to make him exceeding fruitful. The word is double. So there again is multiplication exceedingly, or exceedingly, and fruitfulness exceedingly. And that, and then also kings and nations coming from him. And that's the promise and reward, promise for reward in Genesis 17. And then in the biggest test ever of his life, Genesis 22, when he was required or asked to offer Isaac as a burnt offering, then we see the promise in Genesis 22, 15 through 18. Now let's pick it up there and read again the promise for obedience in the greatest test of his life. The angel of the Lord called to Abram, or now it's Abraham, from heaven a second time and said, I swear by myself, declares the Lord, that because you have done this and have not withheld your son, your only son, this is the promise, because you've done this, 17, I will surely bless you. Now, we're going to look at that word bless in the next proof, but some people skip over that. That is significantly important. And make your descendants as numerous as the stars in the sky and the sand on the seashore. There we see both the stars and the sand named in the same verse, the spiritual seed and the physical seed or descendants of Abraham. Your descendants will take possession of the cities of their enemies through your offspring. All nations on earth will be blessed because you have obeyed me. So the promise of reward for obedience is the blessing and descendants. Now, let us go see the fulfillment. We've been looking at the requirement and the promise. Now, let's look at the fulfillment of the promise. Now, we saw in Genesis 12:4, Abram left. We saw his obedience in 15. We saw his obedience in chapter 22, offering Isaac. Now, let's look at what happened to him. In Genesis 13, even after he just had left his father's house and gone to the land, the Lord showed him. Now, we see in Genesis 13, verse 2, what has already happened in his life. Genesis 13, 2. Abram had become what? Very wealthy. Now, I want to stop and mention a minute. I pointed this out yesterday. In the last couple of weeks, we studied the names of God. Two of his names are about his abundant supply and provision, El Shaddai and Jehovah Jireh, both revealing God's abundant supply and provision. Abundant, not a little bit. Well, and Jehovah Jireh actually has to do with foreseeing and providing. And we read scriptures in the New Testament before the foundation of the world. God had already done all of his works. The lamb was slain. His works were finished from the foundation of the world. So Jehovah Jireh has to do with foreseeing previous arrangement for provision. And the name El Shaddai has to do with omnipotent, powerful ability to supply aboundingly. Abounding, exceeding supply. Abounding, and that's where we see the Hebrew word exceeding, double emphasis, exceeding multiplication, exceeding fruitfulness in connection with El Shaddai. And it's the all bountiful giver, supplier, provider, his omnipotent power to supply aboundingly, abundantly, and exceedingly. So both of those names, El Shaddai and Jehovah Jireh, it's interesting to point out those names were revealed to Abram. It's significant. Other names of God were revealed later, like in Exodus, Jehovah Rophe was revealed to Moses and Israel, the seed. But the names of God's provision and abundance were revealed to Abram, the man of faith, the man of covenant, the man who kept the covenant and obeyed God fully. Abundance was revealed to him. And so in Genesis 13:2, Abram had become very wealthy in livestock and in silver and gold. Money. God, Abram had a lot of money and a lot of possessions. A lot of money and a lot of possessions. Why? Because he obeyed. Because he kept covenant. It was the reward promised. Praise the Lord. And then you go down to Genesis 13, verse 5 and 6. Now Lot, who was moving about with Abram, also had flocks and herds and tents. Verse 6. But the land could not support them while they stayed together, for their possessions were so great. Their possessions were so great that they were not able to stay together. And then let's go down to Genesis 24. And this is when Abraham had sent his servant to Laban's house to find a wife for Isaac. Said, go to Laban's and find a wife for my son Isaac in Genesis 24. So the servant of Abraham has gone, and he finds and he meets Rebecca, and then he starts testifying about his master. So the servant of Abraham starts testifying in Genesis 24, verses 34 and 35. 24, verses 34 and 35. So he said, that's the servant, said, I am Abraham's servant. Verse 35, the Lord has blessed my master abundantly, and he has become wealthy. He has given him sheep and cattle, silver and gold, men servants and maid servants, and camels and donkeys, possessions, money, silver and gold, and a full, actually an army of servants. You know, the servants of Abraham went and delivered Lot when Lot was taken prisoner. That was Abraham's servants in his own house. He had so many servants. Glory to God. So the Lord has blessed my master abundantly, and he has become wealthy. Glory to God. In the New American Bible, it says, the Lord has blessed my master so abundantly that he has become a wealthy man. The New American Standard says, the Lord has greatly blessed my master so that he has become rich. New English Translation, the Lord has richly blessed my master, and he has become very wealthy. The New Jerusalem Bible says, Yahweh has loaded my master with blessings, and Abraham is now very rich. Glory to God, glory to God. So we see that because Abraham obeyed God, his reward, what happened to him? What happened? Yes, he got a son. He also became very rich, very wealthy, exceedingly, as God said, exceeding. He became a very rich man. So we see the reward, the promise of reward was fulfilled. He was made rich. We see the fulfillment of the promise. He became very wealthy in silver and gold, and he became very rich and richly blessed, and having sheep, cattle, silver, gold, men servants, maid servants, camels, and donkeys. Hallelujah. Well, let's go on to the descendants of Abraham. Let's look at Isaac. Look at Isaac. First of all, we see the promise. To Isaac, Genesis 26, verses 2 through 6, the Lord appeared to Isaac and said, do not go down to Egypt. Live in the land where I tell you to live. Stay in this land for a while, and I will be with you. That was when there was famine in the land, and he was considering going to Egypt. God says, stay here. Stay in this land for a while, and I will be with you, and I will bless you. For to you and your descendants I will give all these lands, and will confirm the oath I swore to your father Abraham. I will make your descendants as numerous as the stars in the sky, and will give them all these lands through your offspring. All nations on earth will be blessed because Abraham obeyed me. Notice that even Isaac is still being rewarded because of his father. Remember when God has promised to you and your seed for 1,000 generations, the seed, the sons, can be rewarded because of the father's obedience. If you had godly parents who obeyed God, you are walking in part of the blessing because of their obedience. Well, Isaac, we actually don't see much of a demand on him, except to stay where he is. but he is still being rewarded because of his father's obedience. He said, because your father, Abraham, obeyed me and kept my requirements. And verse 6, so Isaac stayed in Gerar. Then you go down in chapter 26 to verses 24 and 25. And then more promise. That night the Lord appeared to him and said, I am the God of your father Abraham. Do not be afraid, for I am with you. I will bless you and will increase the number of your descendants for the sake of my servant Abraham. Notice again, Isaac is getting the blessing and reward, not because he actually shows to have done anything great, but because of his father. His father's obedience. For the sake of my servant Abraham. And verse 25, we see that Isaac did keep the covenant. Isaac built an altar. There isn't keeping the covenant. God is his God. God said, I will be your God. Well, 25, Isaac kept that. He kept honoring God as his God. In Genesis 26, 25, Isaac built an altar there and called on the name of the Lord. He obeyed God and he honored and worshiped God wholeheartedly, whole devotedly. Praise the Lord. Now, what is the fulfillment of the promise? What is the fulfillment of the reward? Or let's see the fulfillment of the reward. Well, start with in Genesis 25, 5, Abraham left everything he owned to Isaac. Everything he owned to Isaac. So, all the sheep, cattle, silver and gold, men servants and maid servants, and camels and donkeys that we read about Abram having in Genesis 24, he gave all of that to Isaac. He left everything. So Isaac starts out rich. He's the heir of wealth, great wealth. And then God added to his wealth. He started out with great wealth and God added more to it. In Genesis 26 is where God required him to stay in the land. And in verse 12, Isaac planted crops in that land. He stayed. And the same year reaped 100-fold because the Lord blessed him. So Isaac started out rich. And then planted some crops and reaped 100-fold of his crops. And verse 13 says, the man became rich and his wealth continued to grow. He started rich. His wealth continued to grow. He started rich. His wealth continued to grow until he became very wealthy. Verse 14, he had so many flocks and herds and servants that the Philistines envied him. The Philistines envied him. And so then in verse 16, then Abimelech said to Isaac, because Abimelech was the king of that area where he was living, they still didn't own the land. They were sojourning in the land. They were just living there as aliens. God said, the land where you are now an alien. So they were aliens there. That land was occupied by these Philistines. And Abimelech was the king. And verse 16, Genesis 26, 16. Then Abimelech, that's the king of the land where they were, said to Isaac, move away from us because you have become too powerful for us. And the King James says too mighty or mightier. Now that word actually means numerous. In the Hebrew, mighty, powerful, it's also numerous. Numerous and vast. You have become too numerous for us. So Isaac started out as the heir of a wealthy man. He started out with wealth and riches, and he increased and multiplied more and he became, his wealth continued to grow until he became very wealthy. He had so many flocks and herds and servants that the Philistines envied him, and the king Abimelech said, "Move away from us. You are too powerful, too mighty, too numerous for us." So we see the fulfillment of the promise. Isaac became very, very, very wealthy. Now, go on to the next descendant, Jacob. Look at Jacob. There again, God made promise to Jacob. In Genesis 28, after he had left his father and mother, and he was heading out on his own, in Genesis 28, 12 through 15, it says, he had a dream in which he saw a stairway resting on the earth with its top reaching to heaven, and the angels of God were ascending and descending on it. There above it stood the Lord, and he said, I am the Lord, the God of your father Abraham and the God of Isaac. I will give you and your descendants the land on which you are lying. The promise again. Verse 14, your descendants will be like the dust of the earth, and you will spread out to the west, to the east, to the north, to the south. All peoples on earth will be blessed through you and your offspring. I am with you and will watch over you wherever you go, and I will bring you back to this land. I will not leave you until I have done what I have promised you. So God is saying, just as I have been the God of Abraham and Isaac, I am now going to be your God. Just as Isaac continued the covenant with God, we read it in Genesis 26, 25, Isaac built an altar and called on the name of the Lord. That was his acceptance of that covenant responsibility to carry on the covenant with God, and that God would be his God. He would serve God wholeheartedly, wholly devotedly. And Isaac built an altar. Isaac carried on that covenant. Now we see Jacob carries on the covenant. He picks it up and carries it. Genesis 28, 20. Then Jacob made a vow saying, if God will be with me and will watch over me on this journey I am taking, and will give me food to eat and clothes to wear, so that I return safely to my father's house, then the Lord will be my God. He says, I will take this covenant. Verse 22, and this stone that I set up as a pillar will be God's house. In other words, it was like an altar. And of all you give me, I will give you a tenth. Now we see the tithe in Abraham's life, where he gave the tithe to Melchizedek. Tithing is part of covenant with God. Now Jacob picks up the covenant, says, you will be my God. This stone will be like an altar. And of all you give me, I will give you a tenth. Jacob vows to tithe. Hallelujah. He is keeping the covenant that Abraham made with God and that his father Isaac had continued. Now, because Jacob picked up and carried and walked in the covenant, what happened to Jacob? Let's see the promise fulfilled in Jacob's life. Genesis 30, verse 43. Genesis 30, verse 43. Jacob, in this way, the man Jacob grew exceedingly prosperous. Now, this is when he is in Laban's house. And actually, Laban had tricked him many times, changed his wages many times. And in spite of all the trickery, Jacob still increased and multiplied. In spite of all the tricks of Laban, Jacob continued to increase and multiply. And in verse 43 of Genesis 30:43, Jacob, in this way, the man grew exceedingly prosperous. There's the word exceeding. It's the promise even given to Abraham, exceedingly prosperous, and came to own large flocks and maid servants and men servants and camels and donkeys. Now, remember, Jacob left home. He did not at that time inherit the wealth of Isaac, which Isaac was very wealthy. And Jacob did not inherit that. Jacob left home with a stick, nothing but a stick, no possessions. And he grew from zero. From zero, he grew exceedingly prosperous and came to own large flocks and maidservants and men servants and camels and donkeys. God did for him exactly what God did for Abraham, and Jacob started at zero, with zero. And then in Genesis 32, verses 9 and 10, Jacob is going back to his homeland. He's going to meet Esau. And Jacob prayed, O God of my father Abraham, God of my father Isaac, O Lord who said to me, go back to your country and your relatives, I will make you prosper. I am unworthy of all the kindness and faithfulness you have shown your servant. I had only my staff when I crossed this Jordan. Now I have become two groups. From only a staff and no possessions, he has become two camps, two groups, two multiplied companies. Praise the Lord. Now join me again tomorrow. And remember, God loves you. You're blessed and highly favored by the Lord.